إلا أحمد بن حنبل عن أجله الأفضل وقال قراءة القرآن
So Sidi Ahmed ibn Hanbal radiallahu anhu, he saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 99 times in his dream. And in one of them, he was asked, of all of the things that draw a slave near to Allah, which one is the greatest? And he said, and Allah answered him, recitation of Qur'an. And he said, Ya Allah, with understanding or without understanding? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to the Imam, answered him, Bifahmin or bighayri fahmin, with understanding or without understanding? In other words, even an ajami who doesn't understand what they're reading, they're drawing close to Allah with the Qur'an. So in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the likeness of the one who remembers Allah and the doesn't is like the living and the dead. That's the analogy in the dunya. Somebody remembers Allah is hay, qalbuhu hay, his heart is alive, so he's alive. And the one who doesn't remember Allah, qalbuhu mayyit, so he's mayyit, his heart is dead, so he's considered dead. And in a hadith, it's a good hadith. It says, make remembrance of Allah until they say he's a madman. Because one of those mad people do is they talk to themselves all the time. So if you see a person remembering Allah all the time, they look outwardly very similar to people walking around talking to themselves. So if somebody doesn't know what he's doing, like if some of these non-Muslims see you walking down the street doing dhikr, they'll think maybe he's crazy, he's talking to himself. So that's what the hadith means. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in another hadith which is also sound, and it's in different narrations. Al-Hakim relates to Imam Malik, should I not tell you what the best of all of your actions is? And the most pure in the sight of your Lord? Your King? And the most exalted in all of those things that you do that are in degrees, it has the highest degree? And better for you in spending wealth of gold and silver? And better even that you go out and meet your enemy in jihad? And by going out and meeting them, you strike them and they strike you, you kill them and they kill you? They said, of course, tell us, Ya Rasulullah. Remembrance of Allah. And in explanation of that hadith, because you say, how could that be better than jihad or something like that? The ulama, radiallahu anhu, say, Zikr Allah is a ghaya. It's the end. That's why we were created, to remember Allah. Whereas jihad and anything else is a wasila, it's just a means. And there's no means in the world that's better than the end. And so the reason that we were created is to remember Allah. And that's why it is the highest thing in the dunya, dhikr Allah. Allah says, Al-Quruni, Al-Kurkum. So whoever remembers his Lord, Allah remembers him. And whoever Allah remembers, he's enriched him in the dunya and the akhirah, he's in need of nothing. And And one of the things about dhikr, which is not the same as other ibadah, like hajj or siyam or things like that, or prayer even, is that dhikr can be done with all of your acts, and there's no specific time that limits it. All of the human acts, including going to the toilet, having sexual relations, eating food, all of these things have dhikr related to them. And they say that the one who's in a state of remembrance with Allah, he's never afflicted by a calamity, ever. Because whatever afflicts him and he was in a state of remembrance of Allah only raises him in rank. If he dies and he's remembering Allah, he's a martyr. So this is the treatment for the foul soul, the foul nature. That's its treatment, is to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَابْدَى بِالِاسْتِغْفَارِ وَالصَّلَاةِ عَلَى جَبِيرِنَا إِلَى الْخَيْرَاتِ
قَالُوا أَنَّ كُلَّ خَرَعَةٍ أو دُعَاءٍ مَأْمُورٌ بِأَنْ تَبِيرِ الصَّلَاةِ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَبْلَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَظِيمٍ اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.
He says, so he said, when you want to do dhikr, you begin with istighfar. Because dhikr is to purify yourself, and obviously the reason that you need purification is because of wrong actions that have been acquired. So you begin that process by asking Allah to remove those wrong actions. And then, if Allah removes the wrong actions, then the dhikr after that you do will remove the bad effects of those wrong actions. Because the wrong actions have effects. And so you pray on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because prayer on the Prophet acts as a muraddi for the heart itself and purification of the heart. Which is why also most of the later ulama all encourage those two specifically, because of the wrong actions that so many of us are engaged in, but also because by ijma of the ummah, the only dhikr that's absolutely guaranteed to be accepted by Allah is salat ala nabi. Anybody who says Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad is maqbool.
Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallam. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala nabi.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded a command that He Himself began with, which you don't see that anywhere else in all the things Allah has commanded us to do. He doesn't begin with it except prayer on the Messenger of Allah. So He, Allah Himself, said, Inna Allah wa malaikatahu, and then He seconded it with His angels. They do this. And then Allah says, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Pray on the Messenger of Allah and do taslim. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa sallim. So whoever prayed on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam one time, Allah prays on him 10 times according to the Sahih Hadith. And he said, whoever Allah has prayed on 10 times, what else do they need in this world and the next? So, just pray on the Hadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Marra wahida. Allahu Akbar. As-salamu.
Salatu alayhi wa sallam. As-salamu alayhi
So the Prophet ﷺ said that prayer upon the Messenger of Allah is light in this world, light in the grave, and then light on the sirat. So in other words, it will give you light, guidance, in when you need it. will give it in the grave. It'll make your grave light instead of dark, and then it'll make the sirat light so you can see to get across it.
Nur
al qalbi.
Nur
al qalbi. Light in the heart. So he said, no one else we've been commanded to pray on the Prophet ﷺ. And therefore, when you pray on the Prophet, and that's why usually it's good to begin with the actual ayah, because by beginning with the ayah, then you're actually, it's called intifad amrillah. You're in fulfilling the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have to do it as a wajib at least once in your life to fulfill that command. But you can do it every single time that you do the prayer on the Prophet. And so the one who prays on the Prophet ﷺ, he should have the same adab that would he have if he's remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's mandir for him to be in wudu. It's mandir for him to be facing the qibla. It's mandir for him So those things that are mandir for prayer are mandir for prayer on the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also istihbar, and see what he said. And then that you have istihbar of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that you pray as if you were in his presence. You should, in the same way that when you pray to Allah, you pray as if you're in the presence of Allah, كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُمْ مِنْ تُكُنْ تَرَاهُمْ مِنْ يَرَاكُ. That's ihsan. With the prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should pray as if you were in the presence of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are courtesies of the prayer, the adab that you do when you do the prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like you're going to pray. These are going to be that adab that you should do. Tahara, siwa, cleaning the mouth, perfume, things like that. These are all good things to do. So every dhikr has things that are appropriate for that dhikr. So for instance, when you say La ilaha illallah, what's appropriate for it is that you negate other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that you negate shirk completely. That's appropriate for La ilaha illallah. If you say Alhamdulillah, then what's appropriate for that is that you are reminded of the constant overflowing bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of His blessings. Because He's Mahmud. There's Hamad for Ihsan and for the things that Allah has done for you. And then if you say La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, then what you should be doing is you should have a takhallus, which is a removal or completely disengaging from any power or any strength. you're basically admitting that you have no power and no strength before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And therefore when you pray on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what's appropriate for it is it that you are aware of the presence, that you bring the presence of the Messenger of Allah as if he was before you, and all the wonderful things that he did, the guidance that he's given us, and all of those things that we owe to him as our wasila for teaching us la ilaha illallah, for teaching us about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then to remember that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself that gave prayer on this Messenger of Allah and his angel, and that you're participating in something that Allah himself says that he has done and his angels.
كذلك يجوز اجتناب اللحم في الجنس لان بعض اللحم حرام وبعضهم يشتري به الجنس على راي ان يتقاطع العربيه كحاله الجنس الناس لم يكن حتى لو تعطيه.
So another thing about dhikr that you should avoid is what's called lahm, which is an incorrect pronunciation. You should avoid it to the best of your ability. Obviously some people do not have the ability to pronounce everything in Arabic properly, but you should avoid it and you should try to learn how to say things properly. He said some of these things, mispronunciation is considered a ma'asiyah or a khata, but others are actually ridda, that it can take you into getting out of Islam. So the ajami, for instance, that people can't pronounce bad and wa, things like that, they don't make a tamiz or say whatever, like zalim instead of balim. Those people, if they really can't pronounce it, there's a thakal in their tongue, a heaviness, that's ma'dur. He has an excuse by sharia. If he's done all that he can to not pronounce it like that, and yet he's still incapable, then he's ma'dur, and he still would do the dhikr, even though it's pronounced incorrectly, and he gets the reward, and there's no wrong action that is entailed by doing that. And then one of the greatest of also of the worship is meditating on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
قال تعالى الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والارض.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention in the Quran of those people who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala standing, reclining, sitting and on their sides, reclining on their sides. And then he says, those who reflect on the creation of the heavens and the earth. And so Allah has coupled with dhikr, fikr, or tafakkur. And so it's said that the action of the heart, which is tafakkur, that's why the heart is there to be able to do this tafakkur. The action of the heart is better than all of the actions of the limbs. And this is why in one narration there comes a tradition that says to reflect for one moment's reflection is better than a year of ibadah.
قال انه على اربعه انحاء تذكر بايات الله تذكر في خلقه وعدالته الا تذكر في احد تذكر في وعد الله الجوال وعدالة لا تولد وقامت تذكر في وعد الايام وعدالة لا تولد وقامت تذكر في جرائم مع احسان الله وعدالة لا تولد كل من الحياه من الله كل حياه من الله هي علامات تذكر.
So he says that the signs of reflection are four directions. One of them is reflection in the signs of Allah, and another is reflection in the creation of Allah, and its signs, and this leads to love. So that leads to love by reflecting in the signs that Allah has made and in His creation, and the sign that the creation indicates about Allah leads to love of Allah, because you see all that Allah has done for the human being. And then the next one is reflection in the promise of Allah of the rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised for His creation and those signs that are related to that. And its sign leads to a desire of Akhirah and of these things. Because Allah promised you Jannah, so the sign that you've reflected on that promise is that you have a raghbah, you have a desire for Jannah. And then there's also reflection in the punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised creation. And the sign of that is that there is rahba or fear engendered, so the person avoids disobedience. And then there's also reflection in the weak nature of the self, the jafa of the self, the harshness of the self towards Allah despite Allah's ihsan to him. So when you think of all that Allah has given you, and then you see how you respond in the little that you actually do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is a type of reflection that leads to shame before Allah. In other words, the sign that somebody has done this type of reflection is they have a haya with Allah. They feel ashamed before Allah, that Allah has done so much with them, and they have not done anything for Allah. No.
من شوي ما زال قريب يعني 15 دقيقة
يبقى أن الأواصر يقول في الأنباء كل ما يقول غير هنا يبقى من بعشاء يبقى الأواصر وأن العلم قائم أنه يريد بعض الأنباء ومن كان بالخير وأعلم من كان بالكان حالقا يفرق بين خير الشر بالخير من الخير فهو الذي يفرق بين الشر والخير.
So the heart is the thing that differentiates between good and evil, and the source of all of these matters is related to the inrushings that occur to the heart. So the heart has these inrushings, khawatir, that occur to the heart. It's like a guest that descends upon the heart, and there are different types of them. Inshallah, because we're not going to unfortunately have much time with Shaykh Khatri, so we'll just open it up for the last section, about 15 minutes before we pray Asr, for some questions. People have questions?
So يسرع عن مثل المتصوفة الذين يشتغلون بذكر الله وقد ممكن يهملون واجبات أو
أنظر ما يجب على المكذبين وأحضر طاعتي وأحضر أعمالي تعلم العلم قبل كل شيء تعلم العلم قبل كل شيء فضل عني قبل كل شيء لا يقدر من عبدي في عبد شيء ما دام يهم ضرر عني.
So here, the question that Hayes asked was about people like now what they call mutasawifa. Imam al-Maqari differentiate between Sufiya and mutasawifa. Mutasawifa are people that yudda'una Sufiya. They claim to be Sufis. And so one of the signs often of those people is that they'll do a lot of dhikr of Allah, but they ignore wajibat. And so he asked what's his opinion, and the Shaykh said that the first and foremost obligation on every human being is to learn knowledge before anything. And a human being is nothing until he's learned the Farda'in. He has no maqam, nothing with Allah. He's nothing. It's like an animal. He's the same. Because Allah has commanded him with a very minimal amount of taklif to learn how to do certain things. And the Farda'in, if he hasn't learned them, then he's living the life of this, like, worse than animals, because he's astray and he's not doing anything to get out of his error. And those people who learn knowledge, and Shaykh Wadd al-Khadim mentioned many of the ulama, Imam Sa'rani, Imam al-Suyuti, all of the great imams of the science of the outward and tasawwuf, all say that before tasawwuf, there has to be fiqh. And if you don't learn fiqh before tasawwuf, then you'll go astray.
لا تصوّف مع جلد
الله. لا تصوّف
مع جلد
الله. لا تصوّف مع جلد الله. تصوّف مع جلد الله. تصوّف مع جلد الله. وعلم عمل صالح معمول بمع جلد الله. لأن الصلاة والزكاة والحج والصيام هذه فرائض ما قبلها شيء قبل الأمة.
So even showing filial piety to one's parents, learning the fard is before that, the fard'ain. In other words, Allah, the highest thing after tawheed of Allah that Allah mentions in the Quran is bir al-walidain. And yet, learning what Allah has commanded you to do as a fard'ain is over bir al-walidain. If you have not done that and you're taking care of your parents and that's preventing you from learning, then you're doing something that's wrong by leaving something's right.
He was just saying مثلاً عن أذكار التي امرأة اللي في الحياة أفضل ما تفعل للذكر.
امرأة اللي حياة لا يحرم عليها ذكر بالذات إذا كانت يا الله المعلم 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 يا الله المعلم